The Sixth Mansion, Chapter 4, of the Interior Castle. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Anne Boulay. The Interior Castle, or the Mansions, by Saint Teresa of Ávila, translated by the Reverend John Dalton. The Sixth Mansion, Chapter 4. The saint explains when God suspends the soul by trance, ecstasy, or rapture, and shows that great courage is necessary for receiving such a favor. What rest can the poor butterfly take with the labors and other afflictions already mentioned? All serve to inflame her desires of enjoying her spouse, and as His Majesty knows our weakness, He continues to prepare her, by these and many other things, to take courage and choose Him for her spouse. You will perhaps laugh at my saying this, and consider it foolishness, because every one of you will think there is no need of courage, and that no woman is so base that would be willing to be espoused to a king. I believe so too, as regards an earthly king, but I tell you, to be espoused to the King of Heaven requires more courage than you imagine, for our nature is too mean and timorous for so sublime a thing. I consider it certain also that this would be impossible if God did not bestow the dowry. Here you will see what His Majesty does in order to conclude these espousals, which I believe are ratified when He takes away the senses by raptures. For if in the enjoyment of them our nature should see itself so near this great Majesty, it would perhaps be impossible to continue to live. I speak of true raptures, and not of certain infirmities of women which we often see, for everything to us seems to be raps or ecstasies, and I think I have mentioned before, some constitutions are so weak that they seem to be dying if they have only of one prayer of quiet. I will describe some kinds of raptures which I have learnt about from those who have had a great deal to do with some spiritual persons, though I do not know whether I shall be able to explain them, as elsewhere I have done, when writing on this subject. I wish also to mention some other things which happen here, which for some reasons it seems proper to repeat again, if for nothing else but that the mansions might go on together in order. One kind of rapture is, when the soul, though not in prayer, being moved by a word which she remembers or hears from God, His Majesty seems to increase the spark before mentioned from the interior of the soul, being moved with compassion to see her so long afflicted with the desire of Him, for being quite inflamed, she becomes, like the phoenix, entirely renewed, and as one may piously believe, her faults are then forgiven, supposing, however, she has the disposition, and makes use of the means which the Church prescribes. Being thus pure, He unites her to Himself, without anyone knowing it, except only themselves. Even the soul herself does not know it in such a way as to be able afterwards to relate it, though she then has her interior senses. For she is not like one in a swoon or fit, where nothing is seen interiorly or exteriorly. What I understand is the case is, that the soul was never so alive to the things of God, nor had so clear a light and knowledge of His Majesty as she had then. This may seem impossible, because if the faculties be so absorbed that we may say they are dead, and likewise the senses, how can it be known that the soul understands? This mystery I cannot comprehend, and perhaps no other creature, but only the Creator Himself. Many other things also I cannot understand which happen in this state, I mean in these last two mansions, which may well be united together, for there is an entrance open to both. But because in this last mansion some things are not manifested to those who have not entered into it, I thought it best to divide them. When the soul is in this suspension, and our Lord considers it good to reveal certain secrets to her, such as those which relate to heaven, and visions seen by the imagination, these she can afterwards relate, because they are so imprinted on her memory that she can never forget them. But when they are intellectual visions, she is not able to relate many of them, because then some of them are so sublime that it is fit for those who live on earth to know them, though when such souls return to their senses they can relate many of them. Some of you do not, perhaps, understand what a vision is, especially intellectual ones. This I will explain at the proper time, since He has commanded me to do so who has the power, and though it may seem a foolish undertaking, still it may perhaps be useful to some souls. But you will ask me, if afterwards there is no remembrance of these high favors which our Lord here bestows on the soul, what use are they to her? O daughters, so exceedingly useful are they, that their utility cannot be expressed. For she may not be able to mention them, yet they are deeply imprinted in the interior of the soul, and can never be forgotten. But if they have no representation, nor are understood by the faculties, how can they be remembered? This I do not understand, but I know well that there remain fixed in the soul certain truths of the greatness of God, that even without faith, which tells her who He is, and that she is bound to believe Him to be God, she would adore Him as such from that instant, just as Jacob did when he saw the ladder on which angels were ascending and descending. Then, no doubt, he told other secrets, which he was unable to relate. And had he not had a more internal light, he would not have discovered such high mysteries. I know not whether I am explaining exactly what I am saying, because, though I have heard it, I am not sure that I remember it properly. Neither was Moses able to relate all that he saw in the bush, but only what God wished him to mention. But had not God discovered to his soul other secrets in a most certain manner, in order that he might see and believe it was God, he would never have been able to endure so many and such great labors. Moses must have learnt amongst the thorns of that bush such great things as encouraged him to do what he did for the people of Israel. And so we, sisters, in the hidden things of God, must not seek out reasons in order that we may understand them, but as we believe He is powerful, so it is evident we ought to believe that a worm, having such limited power as we have, is unable to comprehend His greatness. Let us praise Him exceedingly, that He is pleased to let us know some of them. I have been wishing to hit upon some comparison, by which I might explain something of this subject on which I am now speaking, and I believe there is none which exactly suits. However, I will mention the following. Suppose you enter a room, or closet as I think it is called, of a king, or some great lord, where is a great variety of certain kinds of crystal glasses, porcelain, and many other vessels, placed in such order that on entering they are almost all seen. I was once conducted into such a room, in the house of the Duchess of Alva, where being on my journey for founding a convent, obedience required me to remain 2 days, at the earnest request of this lady. When I entered the room I was amazed, thinking what could be the use of such a variety of things, and I perceived our Lord might be praised on our beholding so many different things. This comparison comes in very seasonably, since it will serve my purpose here. Now though I remained there only for a short time, such abundance was to be seen that I immediately forgot everything, and I no more remembered all the vases than if I had never seen them, nor could I tell what shape they were, but only in general I remembered having seen them. And so it is here, since the soul has been united with God, and admitted into this chamber of the empyreal heaven, which we ought to have in the interior of our souls, for it is evident that since God resides in them, He possesses some of these mansions. And though when the soul is thus in an ecstasy, our Lord is not always pleased she should see these secrets, for being so absorbed in the enjoyment of Him, she is content with so great a good. Yet sometimes He is pleased that this suspension should leave her, and then immediately she sees what is in that room. Thus, when she returns to herself afterwards, she retains the representation of the greatnesses which she beheld, but she can mention none of them, nor does her natural ability attain to more than He was pleased to allow her supernaturally to see. I already acknowledge that it appears something was seen, and that it is a vision seen by the imagination. I do not wish to say it is such, nor to speak of it here, but only of the intellectual vision. Being unlearned, my ignorance is not able to explain anything properly. Hence, if what I have hitherto said be correct, I know clearly it is not I who spoke it. For my part, I consider that if sometimes, when the soul is in these raptures, she does not understand these secrets which God communicates to her, they are no raptures, but some natural weakness. For it may happen to persons of a weak constitution, as we women are, that, by using force, the spirit may overpower nature, and make these persons remain thus absorbed, as I think I have shown when speaking on the prayer of quiet. These have not the character of raptures, for in true raptures I believe that God wholly ravishes the soul with Himself, and He continues discovering to her, as if to His own spouse, some small part of the kingdom which she has gained, since whatever is in this great God is immense. It is everything. He does not wish to have any disturbance from anything, either from the faculties or from the senses, but He immediately commands all the gates of these mansions to be shut. That gate only where He resides is left open for us to enter at. Blessed be such great mercy, and justly will they be accursed who will not make use of it, but lose so great a Lord. Oh, my sisters, what we abandon for Him is nothing, and what we do is nothing, or what we can do for such a God, who is thus willing to communicate Himself to a worm. And if we hope to enjoy even in this life so great a good, what are we doing? Why do we delay? What recompense can be made us for being hindered only one moment in our search after this Lord, as the spouse did through the streets and roads? Oh, what a mockery is everything in the world, if it do not advance us and help us to reach this Lord, even though all its delights, riches, and pleasures were to last forever, and were as great as can be imagined. All is filth and nastiness when compared with these treasures which are to be enjoyed without end, and even these are nothing to be compared with possessing the Lord of all these treasures, the Lord of heaven and earth. Oh, the blindness of men! When will this clay be taken from our eyes? Though amongst us who are religious, it does not seem so great as to blind us, yet I see some small motes, some little specks, which, if we allow them to grow, are able to do us great mischief. But for the love of God, sisters, let us turn these defects to our advantage, in order to discover our misery, and let them clear our sight the more, as the clay cured the blind man, whom our spouse healed. Seeing ourselves, then, to be so imperfect, let us be more fervent in beseeching Him to draw good out of our miseries, that so we may please His Majesty in everything. I have wandered much from my subject, but pardon me, sisters, and be assured that having arrived at these wonders of God's greatness, I mean, having spoken about them, I cannot help feeling great grief when I see what we lose by our own fault. For though it be true they are favors which God bestows on whom He pleases, yet, did we love His Majesty as He loves us, He would give them to everyone. He desires nothing else but to see someone on whom to bestow them, since thereby His riches are not lessened. But to return to what I was saying, the spouse now commands the doors of the mansions and those of the castle and the places around it also to be shut. For, as he wishes to ravish this soul, he takes away her breath in such a manner, though the other senses sometimes continue a little longer, yet the speech is quite taken away. At other times, she is deprived of all the senses at once. The hands and body grow so cold that there seems to be no life, and sometimes no breath is perceived. This lasts for a short time, I mean in this state. For when this wonderful suspension leaves her for a time, the body seems in some degree to return to itself and take breath, that it may afterwards die again, and so give greater life to the soul. Still, this ecstasy does not continue long. But though it is taken away, the will remains absorbed, and the understanding is so alienated, and this lasts for a day, or several days, that it seems incapable of attending to anything except to what tends to excite the will to love. To this it is quite alive, but asleep as to placing its affections on any creature. When the soul returns to herself again, what is her confusion? And what most earnest desires has she not of giving herself wholly to God in whatever ways He may wish to employ her? If the former prayers produce such effects as those mentioned before, what will such a sublime favor as this produce? She wishes she had 1,000 lives, in order to give them all to God, and that all things on earth were tongues, in order that they might praise Him in her stead. Her desires of doing penance are very great, nor does she suffer much in performing it, for the power of love makes her scarcely feel whatever she does, and she sees clearly the martyrs did not do much in suffering their torments, because with this assistance from our Lord, suffering becomes easy, and hence such souls complain to His Majesty when an opportunity of suffering is not given to them. When this favor is bestowed upon them in private, they value it very highly, because when it happens to them before other people, the shame and confusion it leaves is so great that it deprives the soul in some manner of the suspension she enjoys by the trouble and anxiety she feels from thinking what those will say who saw it. She knows the malice of the world, and that men will not perhaps view it as it ought to be, for that which they should consider as an opportunity for praising our Lord, they will probably make use of for throwing out censures and rash judgments. This trouble seems to me to be, in some manner, a want of humility, though she cannot help it. Because if such a person desire to be despised, what does she care for their censures? One who was in this affliction heard these words from our Lord: "Be not troubled, for they either will praise me or find fault with thee. In either of these two ways, thou wilt be a gainer." I knew afterwards that this person was exceedingly animated by these words, which I here relate to you in order to help any who may be in the like affliction. It seems our Lord wishes all to understand that this soul is already His, and that no one must touch it. Men may meddle with the body, with honor and estates, for from all of them His Majesty will derive glory, but they must not touch the soul. And if she do not, by a very culpable boldness, leave her spouse, He will protect her against all the world and all the powers of hell. I know not whether I have been able to make you understand something of what a rapture is, for to explain it fully is, as I said, impossible. And I think nothing has been lost by what I have said, thereby endeavoring to understand what it really is. In counterfeit raptures, the effects are very different. I say counterfeit, not that the person who has them intends to deceive, but she is deceived. And as the marks and effects do not correspond with so great a favor, such a person falls into such disgrace that justly is another not believed afterwards on whom our Lord really bestows the favor. May He be praised and blessed for ever and ever. Amen. Amen. End of the Sixth Mansion, Chapter 4.